All right, everyone, thank you so much. My name is Brandon Palin. I'll be the moderator. Pretty difficult task of holding up white signs. Otherwise, there's some great presentations lined up, so I'll let them do their jobs and fulfill the obligations of introducing themselves, but I'm looking forward to hearing what they have to say. Just as a reminder, each presentation is about 20 minutes with 5 minutes for Q&A at the end. We'll try to be as respectful as possible on those timelines, but we'll see how things go. With that, Lou, Sarah, please.
Hi, my name is Sarah Sheldon. I worked in municipalities in North Carolina for about 15 years. And for the last 2 years, I've been working with Timmons Group doing asset management. Lou.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lou Garcia with Timmons Group. And I don't know, I've never worked in the state of North Carolina. I worked all around the country. I have roughly about 30 years experience working in asset management. So go ahead and get started here. So I have a quick question. We're going to start talking about some maintenance management strategies. Kind of a show of hands, how many people here have a formalized maintenance management plan or even just a maintenance management strategy on maintaining your assets? So we got a few hands. Good, good, good. How about then a formalized asset management plan? Okay, a few less hands. All right. Well, what I'm going to talk about, and I have to give some disclaimers here up front, is some tool sets that we employ with our clients. And yes, it says CityWorks. I don't know if anybody knows CityWorks. I know a few of my clients are here. But CityWorks is GIS-based, so all your data sits in your GIS, so that's the hook here. But I know other systems that are out there that do similar things to CityWorks have similar capabilities, but I will be showing you specifically some of the things within CityWorks, but the theories are all the same. What you use to put in practice can vary. So with that, I'm gonna hit this first slide. So the tool set I'm gonna show to you today, just to give you some idea, it's being used around the country. These are the clients we're working with right now that are using the tool sets we're gonna show to actually develop a maintenance management strategy, kind of get an idea for that, turn it into a maintenance management plan, and then do real asset management with it. So just some real quick review here. I mentioned CityWorks is based on GIS. I'm not gonna preach on this one, but some things that are important to us are, you know, and you're all GIS people, right? Points, lines, polygons, related assets can all be modeled within your GIS. And I'm gonna talk about the data models in a minute. And again, you're GIS people, so don't have to hit this too hard, but you know, Culvert, you got different Esri apps you can use to create that data, define your attribution, manage the geometry, and then likely your tool set, you can create web maps or services, and you can see your data within your GIS, right? All right, so first quote I have here, and I thought this was really interesting, and I don't know if this rings true with people, but this is a quote from Denora Sanchez, who happens to work with CityWorks, but she said something very interesting about a year ago to me that it hit home, right? We need to move from managing assets to asset management. So everybody agree with that? Yes? I see a few nods, okay. And then the second one is my favorite quote, right? It's, if you don't know where you're going, you're gonna end up someplace else. So the idea behind that is you gotta have a plan. If you go into something without a plan, you're never gonna achieve what you set out to do because you have no clue what you wanna do, right? So here we go, some basics. So in our experience, two things that need to be looked at when you're doing asset management. And some maintenance management basics, we look at operations. So operations are things like determining a need for action. Is this preventative maintenance or is it reactionary? Pretty simple, right? You know, pretty self-explanatory there. You have to act. You have to go out and actually do something on your asset. And then in our world, you need to measure that. We like to measure equipment, labor, materials. And you also want to do an inspection and develop a condition score of that asset, you know, whether you're using an A through F ranking or 1 to 100, doesn't really matter. And I like to put these in what we call the tactical group. So these are things that happen all the time, every day. This is your operations. This is what your maintenance crews are doing. Management, on the other hand, has some different goals. You know, they're looking at levels of service, KPIs, you know, key performance indicators. I don't know if I need to go into define what levels of service are. So everybody, raise your hand if you don't know what levels of service are. Okay, so you guys do. Planning, and I'm talking planning not just for next year, but looking 5, 10, 15, 20 years in the future. And, of course, budgets. Somebody's got to pay for all this, right? So I put that in the strategic category. So here's a very classic definition of asset management, right? Minimizing cost, delivering the service levels that people want, but at an acceptable level of risk. And the way we define risk is your probability of failure. You can also look at consequence of failure, and you can also develop what's called a risk mitigation score. And then you get into what's called business risk exposure. And that's when you start throwing budget numbers at these factors. So probability of failure is, when do I think this asset's going to fail? What are the consequences? If an asset fails, what else is it affecting? You know, is this a sanitary sewer force main that happens to run through a wetland? That thing fails, you've got other types of cascading issues. And then your risk mitigation, what kind of risk are you willing to live with? And what are your action plans to take care of those things when things go bad? And then when you start looking at your business risk exposure, you might want to start adding budgetary numbers to those. So true story, one of our clients has this real tiny client named Anheuser-Busch. If the water main to Anheuser-Busch breaks, it's a problem, right? It's going to affect a lot of things. Maybe the mental health in the area, I'm not sure, but it's not good. All right, so when we start looking at things beyond the theory, right, we start getting to what do we really need to start doing when we're looking at the goals of a CMMS system and modeling your assets? And these are just things that we feel are important. So it's really this asset inventory and condition, right? You like to model that in your GIS, makes a lot of sense. You want to start looking at your work history and start getting those risk scores, right? And then you have to consider that future funding. And that really is what you need to do for your actionable plan. Anything to add? All right. So CityWorks has this tool called Operational Insights. Like I said, I'm sure there are other systems out there that have other tool sets that do similar things. But within, and you're going to see why CityWorks is important with this, with the GIS, within CityWorks, you start to model out these things, your probability of failure, your consequence of failure, risk mitigation, again, the BRE, and you get this asset management plan, and you start measuring your performance against the things you're setting out to do. So it can tell you things like, how often are you maintaining your assets often enough? Are you not maintaining them often enough? Are you doing the right things to them? So some of the things we start looking at are here, and they're highlighted in things like condition score, you know, COF factors when you're looking at consequence of failure, the depth of an asset. Obviously, the deeper it is, the more expensive it is. You start looking at soil types. What's the cost of construction now? The diameter of that asset, the accessibility, critical crossings. I've worked in Baltimore City. I don't know if you guys remember, this made the news. I want to say it was about 8 years ago. They had a water main blowout in a major downtown intersection. The criticality of that failing and everything it affected was a big deal. You know, it shut down a major intersection in downtown Baltimore for about 4 months, took out multiple other utilities. So when we start looking at these factors that we want to do, how are we going to model these, right? This is where we start getting back to the GIS and how we're going to do that. So some quick examples, remaining useful life. We can start looking at the years that it's been in service. We can start looking at things like I mentioned, wetlands or waterways. What's the distance from a waterway and why is that important? So these factors, which you really need to start doing, and here's where we get into the GIS, you start looking at how you can model these things within your GIS. This is incredibly important because within CityWorks, it's not a lot of rocket science. It's pretty basic, right? But you have to actually do more work inside your GIS and get these fields filled out within the attribution, redesign your data model to be able to support the tool. I know the other systems that are out there are going to have very similar requirements. So at a GIS conference, it all comes back to the GIS.
And so some examples of the data that you're looking at to expand within your GIS is things like those vulnerable populations. If an asset fails, what people are impacted? We learned through COVID, there's a lot of school groups, a lot of elder care facilities that maybe were overlooked in the past. You can take a look at what data you have now that you've built on the last couple years and add that into your models here. So you're not only looking at if the asset fails, what populations are impacted, what environmental areas are impacted. Lou was talking about wetlands. You know, there's a lot of different components to you that makes up your community. So it's more than just how much is it going to cost if an industry can't function like Anheuser-Busch.
Okay, so then your next step, once you figure out your data model, is now within CityWorks, you have to configure the tool, right? You set up these criteria and these parameters that you want to use to judge your consequence of failure, your likelihood of failure, your risk. And you start then to get things like calculating your risk. So what you do here, and you get these scores developed, and again, it's all based on things you can work out, you know, age of pipe, diameter, material type, distance from waterways, whatever it might be. And you start developing an asset strategy. So this gets into that maintenance management question that I asked you at the very beginning, right? If you've got an asset strategy that says, I want to go out and, you know, flush my water mains at least once a year. So you start running this tool against that. And what you're doing is you're starting to figure out, okay, is the work I'm doing actually effective? Because if it's not effective, why am I doing it? Or if you're actually damaging the asset, because flushing water mains, for those who know, if you do it too often, you're actually decreasing the useful life of that asset. If you don't need to do it for maintenance purposes, why do it, right? You may be based on this tool when you start looking at the inspection scores of those pipes, maybe instead of every year, you want to take it to every 18 months, maybe every 2 years. You're still getting the performance you need out of the asset, but now you're actually increasing the life of the asset. And of course, the inverse is true. If you're not maintaining it often enough, maybe you're also affecting its condition score. But you have to be able to figure these things out. You have to be able to set up your strategy, and you need to be able to look at, you know, how is that affecting the maintenance strategy? So here, now you've done this, you've run the tool, and you're starting to get these results back. And within CityWorks, it'll actually start to show you things within your analytics dashboard. And I'm going to kind of breeze through some of these slides here. But you're going to start to get these graphs and charts. And you start to look at things that are outliers. Those outliers are either assets that are underperforming or maybe something strange is happening to them. And you want to figure out what's going on with those. The assets that show up in the middle, you're doing well. And then, you know, within CityWorks, you can actually create work orders against those assets that are the outliers. I'm sure the other tools do that as well. And you start going back and you do inspections. Why is this particular asset returning with the score it's giving me based on the criteria I'm setting? And of course, on the maintenance side, you're able to look, and again, is the maintenance work I'm doing actually effective against this asset? So, and you get these nice little graphs that show you, okay, if I do certain things, I can expect this kind of life out of my asset. If I do nothing, I'm going to get this kind of life out of it. And that's just based on the criteria that you're entering and the analysis you're doing. So,
yeah, so you might think about roads, for example. There are different treatment methods you can apply to those roads, crack sealing, for example, that can lengthen the life of that road. If you just pave a road and do nothing, it's going to have a total lifespan of X years, right? And if you actually perform certain preventative maintenance measures, that lifespan will be, you know, as high as possible. And so you have to build those maintenance methods into your models here to help get the most life out of your asset. And so that's kind of what these models are showing. If you apply certain preventative maintenance measures, each organization might have different methods that work well in their certain environment. You might choose a method that your neighboring community does not choose, and you can calculate the impacts of those methods using these formulas.
All right. And of course, then you get back to, you know, pictures worth 10,000 words, right? You start to be able to project these condition scores onto a map, very easy to communicate with people to show them what's going on. You know, this is just a quick snapshot. This is what's going on within your community. Green's good, red's bad, pretty easy to follow. And of course, remember, we're still on the tactical side. We're still talking about maintenance. You can start looking at things like this when your assets start falling in these different categories. So if you have an asset that has a low risk, low probability of failure, you may not even need to do any maintenance on that asset. Right, you just might want to let it run for whatever time. You might want to let it, you know, percolate for a while and see what goes on. However, on the other side, on the upper right, you have an asset that falls into that high risk category. So it's got a high probability of failure, and also the risk of that asset failing is great. That one probably falls into that immediate action category, right? You need to do something. You need to do it quick. The goal is to have most of your assets in that middle area because, let's be honest, there's this thing called money and everybody doesn't have an endless supply. But the whole goal is to get your assets more in that middle category. It'd be ideal to get them down into the lower left in the green, but that's probably nirvana and costs a lot of money to get there. But once you start understanding this and you're able to categorize your assets into these different categories, from a maintenance standpoint, you know what you need to do from a maintenance plan. If you remember, I said you need to have a plan of action, you need to have a course. So that's where you're going to end up with this, and it really gives you a good idea of where to move forward, where to start spending some money. And again, that's tactical. So the next thing I'm going to talk about, and a company we work with is, and they are generic, IDS. They're out of Canada. Their product also sits on top of Esri, so it's completely GIS-based. But they really manage the strategic side of asset management. So if you think about it, CityWorks and tools like that, again, tactical, and then tools like this Asset Optimizer I'm going to talk about a little bit are on the strategic side. So when you start getting to budgets. And the way to look at this is, again, with asset management, you've got data collection, you've got geospatial data. You really have to have an entire program to do that. Probably speaking to the choir, so don't need to beat this horse too hard. But when you start putting information into a tool like Asset Optimizer, and it's all GIS-based, you start to look at things like this, where you can build different scenarios. And imagine standing in front of city council and showing them four options of what to do with money. What is it going to cost? You know, I've got what, a $2 million option, a $4 million option, a $5 million option, and a do nothing option. And you can start to see the impact, and you're able to show that graphically based, again, upon how you configure the system of what's critical to you, and you're able to start communicating to them, if I spend this kind of money, these are the results we can expect. This is where my assets are going to fall. Does this make sense to everybody? Just being able to show them multiple options, and you can do this for the next year. You can do this 5 years out. You can do this 20 years out. And it really gives them a graphical idea of what's going to happen based on the amount of money they're willing to spend to do things. Another classic example is a swipe tool. Right side, do nothing. Left side, spend some money, right? You're able to swipe that back and forth. Kind of cool to show that.
And I know from my experience in municipal governments, the budget tends to change a lot right before it gets settled. And so you're able to use tools like this to program in the new dollar figures and say, how is this really going to impact my day-to-day, my maintenance plans, my operation plans, and then show a result like this on a swipe screen and say, okay, council or board, these are the impacts of your decision. If you take away X million dollars, this is what the community is going to deal with. So it's really, really powerful stuff.
Yeah, and this next slide just shows you budget scenarios. And so this is with pavement. I'm not a pavement person, but there's probably 50 different types of treatments you can do for pavement. Those who knew pavement probably shaking their heads. But this tool will allow you to, it's going to strategize for you what repair methodology or maintenance methodology you should choose based on the budget you have or the anticipated budget you have to be able, with pavement, to achieve the PCI score you want. It'll show you optimal plans. It'll show you, based on the criteria, again, you use suboptimal and even, you know, down based on the amount of money you have available. So it's showing you on each segment of road what kind of maintenance you should do, what kind of repairs you should do, whether it's, you know, scarifying, is it new overlay, is it total repaving, et cetera. And here's just a good example. This is Caltrans, so out in California, with their budget. And it gets into what they're going to do with that budget. They're able to show, you know, here it goes out to, 2030. They're able to project what kind of budget they're going to need for maintaining all the state roads in California. Obviously, they've got quite a bit of money to spend. So with that, I think our time's up anyhow, so we are open for questions. So there are industry standards you could start with right away, and I always tell people, use a KISS principle, keep it simple, right? Don't get too complicated at first. And as you start accruing more and more data, you can look at that data and bounce it off your perceived setup, your scenarios, and you're going to be able to hone those scenarios and fine tune them a little bit better each time you start getting inspection data back. Does that make sense? So I would say you could start today. I'm sure your GIS probably has some basic information in there, like manufacturer, date, expected life, pipe thickness, material. You can start looking at soil types. Yeah. I'm not sure I follow the question. Yes, so, and I should have said this. I'm not a proponent of static plans. I think this needs to be revisited constantly. That's why I think these models you need to fine tune and rerun periodically. So you would pick up those things. I'm against paying for plans that are on paper and sit on a shelf. And they were a really good idea at the time, but they're static snapshots, right? Because things change, and any plan you have for maintaining your assets, I guarantee you, is going to change the moment you start doing stuff. You know, you're going to find things out in the field. You know, you're going to get a 10-year storm or a 100-year storm that you weren't expecting. Just things change. And I think you guys having the tools to be able to adjust and rerun these models and fine-tune them is much more valuable than having a paper strategy. There's one in the back.
So if you've got like a tree population in your GIS, right? Is that something that you've got and you're looking at that as far as like your carbon scores or? Okay, so if you've got that type of data already and you can plug that into the models, and you can look at that score every time you rerun your model and see how that's impacting your sustainability goals. You know, are you getting some improvements there? And look at it, you know, year after year after you rerun the model with any new advancements, any new maintenance methods, things you're doing in your daily operations, how is that, you know, improving or maybe not improving our sustainability goals? You can kind of watch that target.
Thank you.